Hello all, and welcome to Stingray Tom's Florida and another Take 5 for Florida History. Today I'm talking about the giraffe. Certainly not a Florida animal, but a non-native with a long history connected with tourism in the state. The giraffe is not only one of the most unusual large animals on the planet, it's popular with so many people. I've talked to dozens of people in zoos over the years who agree it's their favorite animal. In this video, I'll explore a little of why that's so, from some of the most unusual attributes of the tallest animal in the world to how it took its place as the most common exotic animal in Florida zoos. As I always do in my animal videos, I'll tell you where you can visit them, as well as where there are special giraffe encounters. The history of the giraffe in Florida is linked with the state's unique connection with the greatest show on earth, the surprising creation of the safari park, the rise of community zoos, and the development of two of the world's most popular theme parks, which just happen to be the only ones that are also state-of-the-art zoos. Appropriately, giraffes have played an oversized role in Florida tourism. That's remarkable considering we're a state that's famous for alligators and manatees, dolphins and flamingos. One might think that our native species are exotic enough to satisfy millions of tourists, but the zoos where giraffes live are visited by an estimated 25 million people each year. Not surprisingly, I'll be talking about zoos a lot, so let me define what I mean. I know. Zoo is a word we all understand. It's a park or attraction open to the public that contains a variety of animals. I say this because a few of the places I'll mention don't like to call themselves zoos, but they have experiences that are different from those in a traditional zoo, where people walk from exhibit to exhibit. I'd suggest there's a few varieties of zoos in Florida. The first is the alligator farm, a zoo that primarily has gators, crocodiles, snakes, and other reptiles. The second is the aquarium or oceanarium, zoos obviously dedicated to fish and other aquatic animals. These don't have giraffes, of course. The next is the conventional zoo, and the last is the safari park, which offers experiences that give visitors the feeling that they're on an actual safari in Africa. In these two final types of zoo, giraffes have a sizable part to play. As of 2023, there are 16 zoos that are operating in Florida that are the type that would likely have giraffes. The only regular zoo I've omitted from this list is Homosassa Springs State Park, which only has native Florida animals with the notable exception of Lou the hippo. You can see his story in this video. So 16 zoos, 14 of which have giraffes. Only gators are found at the same frequency. The other important aspect I'll cover is the giraffe's economic impact on these 14 zoos. Each zoo generates substantial income from their giraffes, which I'll detail. So off to the zoo, or should I say zoos? There'll be lots of early images of giraffes from promotional brochures and postcards, as well as my photos and videos. I often visit 4 zoos a year, and I'm lucky enough to know several of the animal care staff that work with giraffes. There are even several individual giraffes that I know pretty well. I hope you'll enjoy this look at the giraffe and its history in the Sunshine State. As you likely know, the giraffe is one of the largest land animals. Adults range between 14 and 18 feet, or 4.3 to 5.7 meters in height, making it by far the tallest animal. It's also one of the heaviest, lining up behind elephants, rhinos, and hippos, with an adult weight between 1,800 and 2,800 pounds, or 800 to 1,300 kilograms. Females tend to be smaller than males. The name giraffe comes originally from a compound Persian word meaning flute and leg. Camelopard is an early English name for the giraffe. It's related to our words camel and leopard, of course, which both come from early Greek and which refer to the giraffe looking a bit like a camel while having leopard-like markings. The giraffe isn't related to the leopard, of course, and it's only distantly related to the camel. Both the camel and the giraffe are part of the mammalian order Artiodactyla, along with hippos, deer, antelope, pigs, and cattle.
The giraffe and its only directly related cousin, the okapi, are in the family Giraffidae. Their ancestors split from the rest of the order 20 million years ago, while the okapi and giraffe split 11 million years ago. Okapi are often described as a living fossil since their form is very similar to ones from 10 million years ago. In contrast, modern giraffes are only about a million years old. The name Artiodactyla comes from Greek and means even-toed. We often use the name even-toed ungulates for giraffes and related animals. There are odd-toed ungulates as well, like horses, rhinos, and tapirs. The word ungulate simply means hooved, from the Latin for toenail. Oddly enough, not all ungulates have hooves. Camels don't, though giraffes do. It's interesting that the terms even-toed and odd-toed don't refer to the total number of toes. They all have five toes. What it refers to is how many of the toes they walk on. Two final things about toes and hooves. While ungulates have five toes, much of the time two or three are vestigial and are considered dew claws or are basically non-existent, much like the human tail. The other thing is that there's one more group of animals among the even-toed ungulates. That's cetacea, better known as whales and dolphins. I talked about this in my video on the dolphin. The first zoo to look at is the venerable Jacksonville Zoo, the state's oldest conventional zoo, established in 1914. As Florida animal attractions go, the St. Augustine Alligator Farm is older, predating it by a remarkable 21 years. Like many early zoos, Jacksonville had a simple beginning as it started with just one animal, a European red deer fawn. Today it's one of the largest zoos in the state. I took a look at it recently in my video on the St. John's River. There's about 2,000 animals of 180 species in its collection. Many are endangered, and like nearly all Florida zoos, they participate in various animal conservation programs. Annual attendance is around 800,000 people. The zoo states that its first giraffes arrived in 1957, and as of 2023, the zoo has 10 giraffes, with four others on loan to other zoos. They also have okapi. The giraffes are housed in the Africa area in a habitat with a large overlook. That's where their giraffe feeding happens, though Jacksonville handles it differently than most zoos. They have a total experience package that's more than the general admission. It includes zoo admission, giraffe and stingray feedings, a 4D theater, and train and carousel rides. The additional cost is $8 to $10 more. This is the only way to feed giraffes. Officially, giraffe feedings are unavailable for a la carte purchases. That's interesting since at other zoos, it's pretty common for visitors to purchase several feedings. While giraffes are distributed in zoos throughout Florida, in their native Africa, the current range is tiny compared to the historic one. Not surprisingly, this is due to both habitat loss and hunting. They inhabit savannas and open woodlands, though giraffe in Namibia also live in desert areas. Today there are roughly three areas where they can be found: scattered parts of West Central Africa, East Africa, known as the Great Rift Valley, and in the South. While historically it's been thought that there was only one species of giraffe, scientific study has shown that there are distinct populations which haven't exchanged genetic information between each other for over a million years. This means that recently there have been discussions about whether there is one species or more. Zoologists consider there is either one species that contains nine subspecies, or three species, or four species, or as many as eight species. In general, the differences between giraffes are small. There are different style and color spot patterns and minor differences in body types, so for the casual fan, the debate really isn't important. Now we're going to take a look at our first safari park. This is Africa, USA. It was an attraction in Boca Raton. Camino Gardens Road now runs through the old property, and while there's a historical marker nearby, I just like to look for the hippo. Africa USA opened in 1953 as a new type of attraction. Known as the Safari Park, it took the concept of the African safari and made it accessible to the average American. It's a well-known concept today, one we'll look at more in this video. Africa USA had giraffes, camels, zebras, elephants, monkeys, and more. Visitors could take a boat, hop on a jeep, pulled train, or even do a special trip out to see the giraffes in the back of a jeep. Imagine the feeling of being one of the first people to see large exotic animals like that in Florida and as early as 1953. At the time, the state only had three other zoos, and they were keeping their animals in unfortunately small cages. Sadly, Africa USA was open for only 8 years, but in that time, its novel concept garnered a lot of national attention, including making the cover of Life magazine in 1960. The only other regular Florida attraction to appear on Life's cover was the Magic Kingdom. Africa USA also was featured in Look magazine, Life's main competition. Life and Look were both photographic news magazines. In fact, Look looked very lifelike. By the way, the Magic Kingdom also graced the cover of Look, the only Florida attraction to do so. Africa USA closed in 1961, reportedly because the Department of Agriculture discovered an infestation of diseased carrion African ticks, though that's been disputed. Boca Raton, like much of southeast Florida, was experiencing a remarkable land boom, and the zoo was right in the middle. Between 1953 and 60, the small town mushroomed by more than 600% in population. It's also been suggested that Boca Raton's government felt that Africa USA's existence was inconvenient. Regardless of the reason, after 8 years, Africa USA closed forever. In the time it was open, Florida had gained two more zoos. It may come as a surprise that a zoo in Sanford would be the second oldest in the state. Its beginnings lie in 1923 in a town with only about 6,000 residents. Like Jacksonville, it started with only one animal, a former carnival's rhesus monkey. Named the Sanford Municipal Zoo, it would eventually be located near Lake Monroe in Sanford. By 1975, it had outgrown its confines, and with the help of a young Jungle Jack Hanna acting as zoo director, it moved a few miles west to larger property. Along with the move came a new name, the Central Florida Zoo. You can learn about its early history in this video. Today, it's a medium-sized zoo, home to about 350 animals and nearly 100 species, and has an annual attendance of 300,000. It got its first giraffes in 2014. The visitor feeding program costs $5, and visitors can buy as many feedings as they wish. The zoo chose to do its giraffe feeding on the ground instead of on a raised platform. That gives visitors a good impression of the remarkable size of giraffes. It brings into focus the size and unusual shape of their heads. Shaped roughly like a triangle or a wedge, with a narrow mouth and widening to a high back end, the head has several remarkable features. One are the eyes. The size of golf balls, giraffes have some of the best eyesight among hoofed animals. It makes sense considering their eyes are placed on the top of a wonderful viewing platform. Plus, the eyes are placed in such a way that allows for better binocular vision, like those in carnivores. Secondly, there are the horn-like structures on the top of the head. They're properly called ossicones, and only giraffe and okapi have them. The ossicones are made up of bone, though they develop in the womb as flexible cartilage that's not connected to the skull. This allows for an easier birth. As the giraffe grows, the cartilage ossifies or develops into bone and becomes fixed. Both female and male giraffe have them, though only male okapi do. Male giraffes, known as bulls, will develop larger ossicones and also have a prominent lump in front of the ossicones. In addition, as a bull matures, more and more bone is added to its skull, making it significantly heavier. A bull's massive head allows it to fight other males for supremacy by engaging in fighting called necking. It occurs at low or high intensity. In the former, giraffes will rub and lean on each other, essentially trying to push their opponent off balance. In the latter, bulls spread their legs and swing their necks at each other in an attempt to land blows with their heads. One bull swings while the other tries to dodge the blow. Then it's the other bull's turn. A duel can last for 30 minutes, and while most fights don't lead to serious injury, there are accounts of broken jaws and necks, and very rarely, deaths. Out on Key Biscayne, east of Miami, a park was under development after World War II. The site was once a coconut plantation and would be named Crandon Park after Dade County Commissioner Charles Crandon, who built a causeway to the island. In 1948, a zoo was added to the park. This was South Florida's first zoo, and it would operate until 1980. As can be seen by the sign, the zoo had giraffes, though I don't know when they first arrived. Like the Sanford Zoo, Crandon Park would close up shop and move lock, stock, and giraffes onto the mainland and to a new facility to be named the Miami Metro Zoo. Today it's called Zoo Miami, and it sees about 1 million visitors a year. It has 10 giraffes as well as okapi. They have a behind-the-scenes tour that includes giraffes and offer feedings for $5 or $12. Zoo Miami is one of the 10 zoos in Florida that currently have giraffe breeding programs. On average, about 10 calves are born in the state each year. In the wild, giraffes live in herds of related females and their calves, or bachelor herds of unrelated bulls. The two groups live separately, though it's not unusual for them to gather together. The most powerful bulls can breed with several females known as cows. The gestation period is around 15 months, and cows give birth standing up. Calves come out head and front feet first, and will fall about 6 feet or 2 meters to the ground. They're 6 feet tall at birth and can stand up and walk within an hour. The calves' flexible ossicones lie flat on the head but will lift up in about a week. Calves are cared for in nursery herds of cows who watch each other's offspring. Zoo Tampa emerged in 1957 when the city developed Lowry Park on the bank of the Hillsborough River. The small zoo was part of Fairyland, a park based on fairy tales. The Lowry Park Zoo stayed small, and by the 1980s it was run down. In that decade, enough funds were raised to allow the city to start over. The zoo closed in 1987, and 6 months later, the first phase of a new zoo was opened to the public. The city would continue to add more to the zoo over the years, making it one of the largest in Florida with 350 species and more than 1,000 animals. It also has an annual attendance of 1.2 million, the largest of any of the state's non-theme park zoos. Renamed Zoo Tampa in 2018, it has 4 giraffes and in 2022 began a giraffe breeding program. They also have 2 okapi, and they offer a giraffe encounter that includes feeding and a training session. The cost is between $25 and $30. There's about 90,000 giraffes in the wild as of 2023. However, there was double that number back in the 1970s. Whether they're considered different species or subspecies, there are several that are endangered, while others are threatened. This chart shows the separate wild populations, world zoo numbers, and those in Florida zoos. All these figures are approximations. For Florida zoos, I have a firm count of 80 directly from zoo sources, and there's about 40 more on top of that. Note that all Florida giraffes are originally from eastern Africa, the Great Rift Valley, and don't represent the most endangered populations. Busch Gardens opened in 1959. Initially, it was to be a set of gardens that complemented the new Anheuser-Busch brewery, though August Busch Jr., the president of the company, wanted there to be colorful birds as well. Thus began the second zoo in Tampa. By 1962, there were plans to convert some of the property into a recreation of the African veldt, an open grassland environment similar to Florida's scrublands. By 1966, around 475 animals were exhibited there. That's where giraffes were homed, along with zebras, antelope, and rhinos. Busch Gardens continued to expand, firstly adding more animals and then adding thrill rides. partly in response to the opening of Walt Disney World. By the early 1970s, it had developed into the first animal theme park. Busch Gardens would continue to expand and become one of the most popular attractions in the country. Today it operates 10 roller coasters and has 12,000 animals and more than 200 species. Because it's a theme park, its attendance is different from other zoos and averages more than 4 million visitors annually. The African Veldt, known today as the Serengeti Plain, continues to be the home for the park's giraffes. Busch Gardens has at least 12 and maybe as many as 20 giraffes, and there's almost always young calves in the herd. The park offers the Serengeti Tour, where guests can ride in the back of a truck to visit the habitat. The guided tour lasts about 30 minutes and costs between $40 and $70 per person, depending on how busy the park is each day. These tours are where guests feed the giraffes as well as touch them along with seeing the other animals. It's a popular tour with between 50 and 100 guests each day that generates about $1 million a year. This gives a hint as to the value of giraffes in Florida zoos. There have been many circuses in America. The first was brought over to Philadelphia from England in 1792. We even know that President George Washington, while in office, attended a performance that next year. In the 1880s, the Ringling Brothers of Baraboo, Wisconsin, created a small circus. Over the next decades, their circus would grow, and in 1907, they'd buy out their main competition, the Barnum and Bailey Circus. The Ringlings would combine the two productions in 1919 and become the Ringling Brothers and Barnum and Bailey Circus combined shows. In 1927, John Ringling moved the headquarters of the circus to the small city of Sarasota, where he established its winter quarters. While the winter quarters was known as the place that the circus performers stayed while not touring the country, it actually grew into a popular attraction itself, with visitors paying to see performers who were developing new acts, as well as what Ringling Brothers called the menagerie. This was their collection of animals, many of which toured around the country, but in Sarasota it was, in effect, a zoo. From 1927 until 1960, when it moved south to Venice, it was one of the more popular attractions in the state. Ringling Brothers Circus is believed to have first toured with a giraffe in 1900. At the time, they billed it as the last of its kind, stating on posters that when he's gone, the giraffe will be extinct. While this was certainly the first giraffe that circus goers had ever seen, at the time there was likely 250,000 of them in the wild. Only a couple years later, a poster would show a pair of giraffes. Plus, in 1910, Barnum and Bailey advertised the only baby giraffe in America. By the time Ringling opened its winter quarters, giraffes were a standard part of their menagerie. This means that in 1927, the winter quarters was the first zoo in Florida to have giraffes. In 1946, a Ringling giraffe even made the cover of Life magazine, making the winter quarters the first Florida attraction to have a cover story in the magazine. In 1952, winter quarters was used as the location for the filming of The Greatest Show on Earth, which won the Best Picture Oscar. The movie would use Ringling performers along with its tents and famous circus train, as can be seen here, being blessed as it left Sarasota to go on tour. Yet another circus movie, Walt Disney's Dumbo, released in 1941, shows its circus having its winter quarters in Florida. Here's the scene where storks make their deliveries, including a giraffe. It doesn't matter which millionaires, they get theirs like the butcher and the baker, so look out for Mr. Stork. And let me tell you, friend, don't try to get away. Thank you. Lion Country Safari took up the mantle of the safari from Africa, USA. While the first drive-through wildlife park opened in England in 1966, Lion Country opened only a year later near West Palm Beach. Africa USA used jeeps to take people through the park. Lion Country Safari let visitors drive their cars. They even had a deal with Ford Motors to rent cars to visitors who arrived in convertibles, motorcycles, or vehicles without AC. Looking at these magazine photos, you can see why hardtops and rolled-up windows were important. Yes, the lions would check out the cars, as long as they weren't catnapping, as lions sleep up to 20 hours a day. The era of free-roaming lions ended in 2006 when Lion Country placed its 14 lions in a fenced enclosure. This was done primarily because of a lion incident in a similar park in Canada, though over the years, Lion Country regularly saw visitors open their car doors to get a better look at the African predator. There aren't any reports of a regular guest being attacked by a lion, but in 1969, former Tonight Show host Jack Parr was bitten on the wrist by a lion named Jack Parr. Today, Lion Country Safari still operates the safari as well as a more traditional zoo. They have about 1,000 animals that represent some 100 species, and their annual attendance is around 500,000. They have 18 giraffes and have had giraffes since the park opened. They have a breeding program, and they offer $5 giraffe feedings as well as a giraffe painting experience. It's $300, but includes admission to the safari and zoo for up to 4 people, as well as a painting done by a giraffe right in front of you. 9 Florida zoos offer giraffe feedings. They use romaine lettuce or an equivalent like carrots. It costs about $5 to feed 3 pieces of romaine. A case of romaine yields about 480 pieces of lettuce. That means you can get about 160 feeds per case. That's $800. Even with the rise in the cost of lettuce, a case goes for about $50 to $70. After speaking with people connected with several of the zoos, I've been able to estimate the impact on our zoos. Giraffe feedings are very popular, with the only thing limiting the number of feedings is that giraffes sometimes lose interest. Looking at the numbers I've been provided, it seems that each zoo averages about 3 cases of romaine a day for each 100,000 annual guests. This means a zoo with an attendance of 100,000 would use 1,080 cases a year and generate $864,000. Even if you say the cost of lettuce is $100 a case, that's an income of over $750,000 a year. Let's be conservative, though. Figure $500,000 per 100,000 annual visitors. There's about 4.8 million visitors to those 9 parks. That would generate $24 million from giraffe feedings in Florida. But what of the expenses? Certainly, giraffes aren't cheap to feed, but many of the parks would have them anyway, since the vast majority of animals in zoos don't generate any direct income. Also, the labor expense is quite small. Animal care people aren't the ones operating the feedings. That's done either by entry-level staff or even zoo volunteers. This is why I suggest that giraffes are not only Florida's favorite exotic animal, they are economically the most important animal in the state's zoos. The Naples Zoo developed out of the attraction known as Caribbean Gardens. Botanical Garden opened in 1954, though the land had originally housed one of the first botanical gardens in Florida, Henry Nehrling's Tropical Garden, which opened in 1919. Parts of the Naples Zoo still has ties to both Caribbean and Nehrling's gardens. In 1969, Jungle Larry and Safari Jane Tetzloff added their private collection of animals and created Jungle Larry's Safari at Caribbean Gardens. As time passed, the zoo would evolve, and in 2004, the ownership would be transferred to Collier County. It became Naples Zoo at Caribbean Gardens, and it got its first giraffes in 2010. It currently has four, and they offer a giraffe feeding. They also plan to add okapi in the future to their collection of 70 animal species. While I don't have time here to talk about them, I want to at least mention five other zoos with giraffes. Those are the Brevard Zoo, Gulf Breeze Zoo, White Oak Conservation, Giraffe Ranch, and Rye Road Giraffes. The first two are standard zoos. White Oak is a large facility located near Yulee that offers education and conservation of rare species from around the world. Giraffe Ranch is a mixture of zoo and safari near Dade City, and Rye Road in Bradenton is a small facility with two giraffe and a few other exotic animals, as well as Florida natives. The animals from Rye Road are usually on display at the Florida State Fair, which is where I've gotten to know their giraffes. There was also one other former zoo, which was connected with the Silver Springs attraction near Ocala. Giraffe tongues are about 8 inches or 45 centimeters long, but can even be 2 or 3 inches longer. Other than those of massive whales, they are the longest tongues in any animal. Giraffes use their tongues much the way that other animals use their hands to get food. They are prehensile, meaning they have evolved to grasp and hold. They're able to encircle branches and strip them of leaves, grab twigs to break them off, and even remove bark. Okapi are the only other animals with such useful tongues. Both species are able to clean their noses, and okapi can even lick their eyes. Giraffe tongues are a darker color, purple to nearly black, and it's thought that this developed to avoid sunburn. Animal Kingdom is Walt Disney World's fourth theme park. Over the years, Disney kept an eye on nearby Busch Gardens, and as I covered in this video, it would borrow the idea of an animal theme park. The park opened on Earth Day in 1998. It feels less zoo-like than even Busch Gardens. While there's animals on display throughout the park, guests mostly discover habitats while walking around the park instead of moving from one animal display to another. The zoo is home to approximately 2,000 animals, representing around 260 species. Since it's a theme park as well as a zoo, attendance is at another level. It averages 13 million guests a year, which makes it the third most visited theme park in the U.S. and, of course, the most popular zoo in the world. The park had giraffes when it opened and currently has about 15 giraffes split between the Kilimanjaro safaris and the savannas at the Animal Kingdom Lodge located nearby. It has a breeding program for giraffes and also has okapi. There's currently no giraffe feeding available. Okapi are fascinating animals in their own right. They weren't even known to the Western world until 1901, and its name comes from its name in several languages in the Congo and Uganda areas of Central Africa, the only area where the okapi reside. They dwell in the forest, and if you look closely, you will see they share a few similar features with the much taller relatives. Ignore the zebra-like stripes, and instead look at the long neck, the flexible ears, a triangular head topped with ossicones, and a long tongue. The most recent attraction to add giraffes is Wild Florida. Located in Osceola County, it began operation in 2010 as an alligator farm and airboat tour park. It has a small zoo with Florida native animals and a few exotics. In 2019, it opened a safari park like that at Lion Country Safari. The safari expanded in 2021 and has about 40 different species on display. Its giraffes are located at the end of the safari with an elevated platform to facilitate feedings. Apart from the $5 feeding, visitors can also do a VIP tour of the safari that includes feeding the giraffes, as well as a giraffe painting experience, where a giraffe makes a painting in front of you.
As you can probably see, I'm very fond of giraffes and have been lucky enough to interact with them quite a bit. It's amazing that I know individuals such as Gage, Rafiki, Cupid, Melman, Leroy, and Walter, and to mourn the death of two sweet boys, Emba and George. They are one of the most intelligent hoofstock animals and have a high level of curiosity. They're very popular with zoo visitors and staff alike. Like so many animals, their wild population has continued to decrease over the past few decades, with some groups near extinction. Zoos like these in Florida are important to animals such as giraffes in that they educate the public and provide research opportunities so we can learn more about them. They can be a significant source of funds for zoos, with an estimated $25 million in annual gross income throughout the state. Considering that the cost of buying a giraffe would be anywhere between $5,000 and $60,000, females are usually cheaper than males, by the way, and the annual cost of feeding one, about $3,000, you can see that there's quite a bit of incentive for zoos to have giraffes and offer feedings and other experiences. Since they generate so much income and are so popular with visitors, there's little surprise that the giraffe is Florida's favorite exotic animal. Thank you for watching another of my videos. If you've learned something, please hit the like button and subscribe to the channel to learn more about Florida tourism history. Stingray Tom's Florida, traveling through time around the Sunshine State.